Hi everyone, Raif Derrazi here, and this is your latest HIV news video. Today I'll be covering 10 articles covering topics ranging from Merck launching a global phase 3 trial for a once-monthly HIV prevention pill, MK8527, researchers capturing 1,500 HIV-1 cores using cryo-electron microscopy and why that matters, and WHO recommending injectable Lenacapavir for PrEP, making a new era in long-acting prevention. We'll also look at ViiV expanding low-cost injectable access to 133 countries, the Trump administration forced to restore 6.2 million in slashed HIV LGBTQ plus services, and more. For more immediately breaking headlines, be sure to also follow me on Instagram and X, where I often repost the latest headlines. Links to my socials can be found in the description box below this video. All right, diving right in. Number one, HIV Justice Network. New global data reveals rising HIV criminalization amid stalling legal reforms. New data from the HIV Justice Network shows a sharp rise in HIV criminalization, with at least 65 cases reported across 22 countries in 2024, up from 57 in 2023 and 50 in 2022, and another 48 cases already recorded in the first half of 2025, mainly in Uzbekistan and Russia. These laws often punish people living with HIV for non-disclosure or alleged exposure, even when there's no risk of transmission, like in a recent South African case where a man received life plus 10 years despite no evidence of harm or intent. Edwin J. Bernard, executive director of the HIV Justice Network, calls this a global crisis, emphasizing how enforcement often reflects racism, homophobia, and gender discrimination, as seen in Senegal and the US. While legal reforms have been made in places like Maryland, North Dakota, Mexico City, Colima, Mexico, and Ukraine, 83 countries still uphold HIV-specific criminal laws, far from the UNAIDS goal of reducing such laws to fewer than 10% of countries by 2030. And speaking of HIV criminalization, number two, Verite News, Louisiana upholds its HIV exposure law as other states change or repeal theirs. Louisiana still enforces one of the country's most punitive HIV criminalization laws, making it a felony to intentionally expose someone to HIV, even without transmission, and requiring sex offender registration in some cases, as happened to 68-year-old Robert Smith. Despite being undetectable and unable to transmit HIV for over 15 years, Smith spent 6 months in prison after an ex-girlfriend accused him of non-disclosure and now faces lifelong restrictions. "I've been undetectable for 15 years, but that law still punishes us," he said. Louisiana is one of only 5 states where HIV-related convictions can trigger sex offender status, and black men are disproportionately impacted, making up 74% of HIV-related registrants. While 12 states have reformed or repealed similar laws, Louisiana recently attempted to expand its statute to include other STIs. Advocates argue the law is outdated, scientifically flawed, and it discourages people from getting tested. And they are calling for reforms that would require actual transmission and intent, as well as eliminate the sex offender label. Smith is currently petitioning for removal from the registry, hoping to reclaim basic freedoms like being able to attend a football game. Number three, Advocate. House Oversight Democrats demand records over RFK Jr.'s HIV program cuts. Two senior House Democrats, Representatives Robert Garcia of California and Raja Krishnamoorthy of Illinois, are demanding answers from Health and Human Services Secretary Robert F. Kennedy Jr. over drastic HIV program cuts proposed in the 2026 budget, accusing him of undermining decades of bipartisan progress based on conspiracy theories, like his past claims that HIV doesn't cause AIDS and false suggestions that it stems from paupers or a gay lifestyle. Under Kennedy's leadership, HHS has eliminated the CDC's HIV Prevention Division, canceled a $258 million NIH HIV vaccine project, and slashed dozens of grants, particularly those serving Black and Latino gay men. The lawmakers warned these cuts could result in 143,000 new HIV infections and 127,000 deaths over 5 years. Garcia called the decision absolutely reckless, while Krishnamoorthy added it's scientifically indefensible, it's morally unconscionable. They also noted the cuts jeopardize access to breakthrough prevention treatments like Lenacapavir and coincide with a pause in foreign aid, including to PEPFAR, which Congress had to intervene to save. HHS has until July 31st, which at the time of publishing this video is tomorrow, to turn over internal records justifying the changes. Number 4, DevEx, how U.S. aid can appeal to America First Republicans. As America First rhetoric grows louder, foreign aid experts are urging a Republican-friendly overhaul of U.S. foreign assistance to ensure its survival. At a Capitol Hill event hosted by the Modernizing Foreign Assistance Network, or MFAN, development expert Daniel Rund called for GOP leadership, saying, "We need Republican staffers and reformist Republican members to take this on." With USAID transitioning under the State Department, MFAN has released bipartisan recommendations, including a proposed dual mandate that ensures aid benefits both recipient nations and the U.S., providing tangible returns on investment. Jim Richardson, who led foreign assistance efforts under Trump, emphasized it's not a charity, arguing there's value in aligning aid with American interests. Speakers also critiqued the current system's inefficiencies, like overly complex USAID grant requirements, and called for a focus on measurable impact and self-reliance. CARE's Ritu Sharma welcomed the shift but warned against complacency, and former USAID official James Kunder stressed the urgency. Lives are at stake around the world. Try to make a deep dive on what it is exactly our nation requires of its foreign assistance program. I think there is some reasonable sentiment here to look for ways in which the U.S. can also benefit more directly from the aid it gives other countries. It's also a good idea to help countries gradually become more self-reliant, or help them be able to create other partnerships with the long-term goal of being able to scale back our aid. But it's worth noting that some countries are simply not able to work towards any of these goals at this time, and aside from being our moral imperative to help them out as a global leader nation, it's also in our best interest when it comes to epidemiology and understanding that viruses and disease don't respect man-made borders. Number 5, advocate. Trump admin forced to restore 6.2 million to LGBTQ+ and HIV groups. A federal court has forced the Trump administration to restore $6.2 million in funding to 9 LGBTQ+ and HIV service organizations after a major legal win by Lambda Legal. The affected groups, including the San Francisco AIDS Foundation, Los Angeles LGBT Center, and Baltimore Safe Haven, sued over Trump-era executive orders that sought to cut off funding for any programs promoting, quote, gender ideology, end quote, or diversity, equity, and inclusion, DEI. Judge John S. Teagar ruled that these executive actions likely violate the Constitution, including free speech and equal protection rights, and issued an injunction to stop their enforcement. These provisions seek to strip funding from programs that serve historically disenfranchised populations, Teagar wrote, criticizing the administration's attempt to suppress protected ideas and LGBTQ+ identities. Lambda Legal attorney Jose Abrego confirmed the funding has been restored, saying, "When we fight, we win," but emphasize that the broader legal battle is far from over. Without this intervention, essential services like HIV prevention, mental health support, and youth programs would have faced devastating cuts. Number 6, Washington Blade. DC to receive $300,000 from Gilead for illegal kickback scheme. Gilead Sciences will pay over $316,000 to Washington, DC as part of a larger $202 million settlement across 46 states over allegations of running an illegal kickback scheme to boost sales of its HIV medications. According to DC Attorney General Brian Schwalb, Gilead paid 548 doctors more than $23.7 million between 2011 and 2017 through its HIV speakers programs, offering not just honoraria, but also lavish meals and travel perks to push prescriptions of its drugs, a violation of both federal and local false claims acts. Schwalb stated, "Gilead Sciences illegally boosted sales by paying lavish kickbacks to doctors, and in so doing, cheated both district patients and taxpayers. The company denied wrongdoing, but agreed to settle to avoid litigation." Ironically, amid the scandal, Gilead also received praise in June for its new long-acting HIV prevention injection, Lenacapavir, which the FDA approved and which has shown over 99% effectiveness, a potentially game-changing advancement in HIV prevention. Keeping our attention on Gilead Sciences, number 7, WHO. WHO recommends injectable lenacapavir for HIV prevention. At the 2025 International AIDS Society Conference in Kigali, the World Health Organization made a groundbreaking announcement. It now recommends injectable lenacapavir as a twice-yearly HIV prevention method. This marks the first time a PrEP option only requires 2 doses a year, offering a powerful alternative for people who struggle with taking daily pills or face healthcare access challenges. WHO Director General Dr. Tedros called it the next best thing to a vaccine, noting that it prevented almost all HIV infections among those at risk in clinical trials. This comes as the global HIV prevention effort was stalled with 1.3 million new infections in 2024, mostly among vulnerable populations like sex workers, men who have sex with men, and transgender people. The new guidelines also streamline testing requirements, allowing Len and other long-acting PrEP options to be delivered more easily in pharmacies, clinics, and even via telehealth. While Len is not yet widely available outside clinical trials, WHO is urging governments and health partners to begin rollout immediately. Number 8, ViiV Healthcare. ViiV Healthcare extends voluntary licensing agreement with medicines patent pool to enable access to innovative long-acting injectable HIV treatment. ViiV Healthcare has expanded its voluntary licensing agreement with the medicines patent protocol to include patents for long-acting injectable HIV treatment, not just prevention. This means that generic manufacturers like Aurobindo, Cipla, and Viatris can now develop and distribute more affordable versions of cabotegravir long-acting combined with rilpivirine in 133 low- and middle-income countries, including sub-Saharan Africa. This follows the WHO's updated guidance recommending CAB-LA and rilpivirine as an option for people with suppressed viral loads who struggle with daily pills. Deborah Waterhouse, CEO of ViiV, emphasized long-acting injectables have the potential to transform HIV treatment. We're committed to working with partners like MPP to continue to increase access and reach those most impacted by HIV. MPP Executive Director Charles Gore echoed the importance, saying, "This expansion is a vital addition for people who face challenges with adherence to oral regimens. The move aims to improve global HIV outcomes by offering more personalized, accessible treatment choices to underserved communities." Number 9, Medical Express. Scientists capture HIV-1 viral cores entering the nucleus in unprecedented detail. In a major scientific breakthrough, researchers at the University of Oxford, led by Professor Pei Junzhang, have captured for the first time how HIV-1 viral cores enter the nucleus of human cells, a key step in the virus's infection process. Using advanced cryo-electron microscopy at the UK's National Electron Bioimaging Center, the team visualized nearly 1,500 HIV-1 viral cores crossing the nuclear pore, thanks to a method called cell permeabilization. Their findings, published in Nature Microbiology, show that nuclear pore isn't just a passive gate. It actively decides which viral cores can enter, depending on their shape, flexibility, and ability to bind with a host protein called CPSF6. As Professor Zhang explains, this changes how we think about the nuclear pore. It's not a static filter, but an adaptable gateway that interacts with the virus. This discovery could open the door to entirely new ways of blocking HIV-1 from hijacking human cells and marks a major step forward in HIV research. And last, number 10, Merck. Merck to initiate phase 3 trials for investigational once-monthly HIV prevention pill. Merck is launching global phase 3 trials for its once-a-month HIV prevention pill, MK-8527. Aiming to provide a long-acting alternative to daily PrEP. Backed by promising phase 2 results showing good safety and no major side effects in 350 participants, Merck will now test the pill's effectiveness in over 8,900 people across 16 countries. The Expressive 11 trial will begin in August 2025, while Expressive 10, supported by the Gates Foundation, will focus on adolescent girls and women in Kenya, Uganda, and South Africa, regions hit hardest by HIV. As Dr. Eliav Barr from Merck explains, 1.3 million people acquired HIV in 2023, highlighting the continued need for new PrEP options like our once-monthly candidate. With only 18% of the global need for PrEP currently met, this trial is a significant step toward more accessible and manageable HIV prevention, especially for communities where daily medication isn't always practical. And those are your articles for this week. Links to all these articles can be found in the description box below this video. Be sure to like this video, subscribe if you haven't already, hit that bell so you get a notification every time a new video comes out, and please share this with anyone who might find value in this content. Those are the best ways that you can support me and my channel. Until next week, cheers!